I'll start the session. Today we'll be talking about how do you secure your Android app. This is just to make sure there is, actually we will be seeing how you can hack an Android app. Okay, so the topic says how you secure your Android app, but we'll first see how you actually hack an Android app and can see these tools which we'll be talking about, how anyone else can use these tools to hack your Android app. So just before we start, how many of you are like Android app developers? Okay. And or work for a company who develops Android apps? Okay, so and how many of you have used ProGuard in your, okay, only one. Okay, after today's session, I'll make sure that you all go and use ProGuard in your Android apps. Okay, so let me start by introducing myself. My name is Pranay. I work for Intuit as web developer. I'm also a hobbyist Android developer. I assist this group called Bangalore Android User Group as assistant organizer, where we organize these meetups, and it's a meetup group for Android enthusiasts. Okay, what we'll be covering today, so we'll see what are the current threats to your apps, what are the different tools and techniques which someone can use to hack your apps, what are the tools which are available to protect you from these hacks. We'll see Android build process, like how actually an Android build, app gets built. We'll see an actual, we'll decompile an app and see how someone can get access to your source code, APIs, other things, and we'll see other code protection techniques. So let's start by talking about what are the current threats. So in case you might have heard news that Android is not secure, or you are installing malwares, or there are some apps which are stealing your data. So all these apps, there are some apps which behave like, okay, you think that you are downloading a Angry Bird hacked version, but eventually what happens is it will be an Angry Bird in the background. It will be automatically swiping your contacts or some custom personal details. So people always, so there is a huge piracy issue also in Android. So you would have seen games which are being sold for like 200 or 50 rupees being pirated for free. So what they do is they remove the license protection from the apps and relaunch it as a separate app altogether. Or what they do is they repackage and resell the app. So you will feel that, okay, I'm downloading Temple Run, but it's actually a Temple Run hacked version. All the behavior of the Temple Runs remains the same, but the hacker has just kept some code of their own to swipe your contacts or some personal details. So people can steal your code. So if you have some proprietary algorithm which is staying on the phone, let's say in quiet image processing algorithm, and if you're not using certain code protection tools, it might be very easy, and we'll see today that how people can reverse the app and get access to all your codes. They can also steal your sensitive APIs. So let's say you have some APIs which are not exposed to public. So you have some APIs which is available to only your app. And if someone wants, and someone with a bad intention can get access to all your APIs, and without your knowledge, they might be using the same APIs in their app, and you'll eventually not figure out, and they'll be making money on your, and you'll be incurring the server costs. So what are the different code protection tools which is available in Android, for Android? So ProGuard is one tool which is there in Java, which comes now pre-bundled with Android apps as well. So ProGuard is a free tool which is available, which can help you to obfuscate your code. It also comes with certain features which we'll see. Dexguard is another tool. We'll see one Dexguard protected APK. So Dexguard is a commercial tool by the same developer of ProGuard. It's a little costlier tool, like $500. Altori is also a Java protection tool, but they eventually started supporting Android as well. And then there are a lot of Java obfuscators which works on Android similarly as they work on Java. So these are like some of the protection tools which are available, which can protect your code against what? So these are some code analysis tool, as they called. Ultimately, these are like tools which can be used to reverse an app. So these are like hacking tools which someone can use on your APK. So dex2jar, we'll see today dex2jar. So it's a simple utility. What it does is it's convert a dex file into a jar file. In the next slide, I'll show what exactly a dex file is. Android guard. So this is a pretty good Python utility. It works only on Ubuntu, as in Linux. What it does is it combines a lot of these small tools along with some other additional features, like it can show you a call graph. So eventually when you reverse an app, it will help you to know what is the exact flow of the app. So, and you can run the app and exactly see at a point, okay, when I click this button, what function is being called. And like that, and it will give you the code. So all other features of existing things, it internally uses DexGuard and other DexDumps and other tools. IDA Pro. So whoever has been developing apps for Windows, this is a pretty good tool which is being used in Windows world, where they use these tools to reverse the Windows app. Okay, APK tool is another small tool. So it's just a utility, a jar file which you just use over an APK. It also helps you to give. But all of this tool gives you code at a certain level. We'll see to the dexguard, because ultimately our aim is to see the Java files. So what is the typical Android build process? So how actually an Android app gets built? So we'll understand this process. And in the next slide, what we'll do is we'll reverse the process and see how actually from where we started, how we can reach back on that point. So you have Java files, and there is a Java compiler which compiles the normal Java files to class files. But Android doesn't work on class level. So though you code in Java, ultimately they run on their own virtual machine called Dalvik virtual machine. It is DVM. So Android has written their own JVM port, which is optimized to run on the phones. So it is called Dalvik virtual machines. So they run Dex files. So Dex is a format like class for Dalvik. So when you compile the Java file first, it gets compiled to a class, and there is a separate tool called DX tool, which converts the class files and the libraries into a Dex files. So this Dex files will be ultimately used to run it on DVM. After that, what happens is, so you not only have class files in your code. So you have in Android, if you would have aware of an Android app, it contains images, it contains databases, it contains layout and other files. So this process only compiles the class files and the Java files which you have. But now what happens is APK tool, APK builder is a tool which comes pre-bundled with Android SDK. It takes your Dex files, it takes your all resources and combine and create something called APK. So APK is like an exe in Windows world, okay, which will be used to install an app. Or let's say not an exe, it's kind of an MSI, Microsoft installer, or some kind of this. So APK will be used in Android. So any app which you see in Android, if I am giving an app to you, I'm ultimately passing an APK to you. So this APK gets generated from the APK builder. Now what happens is Android and iOS all works on a signed, some concept of public and private key signing. So what happens is you can't publish this APK. This can't be installed on any phone until it is signed by a key. And the key signing is free. So there is a utility, key signing utility from Java, which is called JarSigner. So JarSigner will be used now to sign this APK and create a signed APK. So all this process is with a one click when you are using Eclipse. If you are using AND, then also this process is you have to run the AND file. That's it. So what will happen is ultimately once the compilation gets completed and when you generate an APK, this is what you will get. And this is what being going in the background. So if you see reverse of the process, so you have an APK file of an app, let's say we'll see a sample app. When you decompile it, you'll see Dex files and resources. When you decompile the resources, you'll see the class file. And when you decompile the class file, you'll see the Java files. So ultimately you can reverse the whole cycle and see the source code of an app. We'll see it today. So where does the protection tool come into picture? So since these are Java protection tools, so one comes when you are compiling to the class file. So these are normal Java obfuscators which works, which whenever you are generating a class file, it will obfuscate the code. In Android, you can also obfuscate your code at Dex level also. There are some commercial tools which works on this level. So this is like two-level protection. So you're not only obfuscating the code in Java, but at the time when the Dex files get generated, you even obfuscate that level. So ultimately, the aim is you are making it difficult to decompile the process. So far, any questions?
What does DX tool actually do?
So what does Java compiler actually do? So Java DX tool is nothing but a kind of converter of class to Dex. So it optimizes the class files which gets generated from the Java compiler for DVM, okay, and create a Dex file. Also, what happens is at this level, at this DX tool, so initially if you are using certain libraries in Android, so at DX tool will combine these libraries along with the source code which is being there with you, okay?
You said this is when we obfuscate the code, it is difficult to
reverse it.
Is it impossible or difficult? So is there a way still we can do it?
Yes, but eventually what will happen is we'll see an obfuscated code and reverse it. So what ultimately you will get back is garbage. But if someone really wants, he can crack it. He'll not able to steal your algorithm, not code, but still able to figure out some way or other to break your app or something like that. So if you see a very simple concept of Windows, Windows being such a big company can't protect people to use a hacked version of Windows, even though they use all the security mechanisms. So if someone wants, they can. But these are some tools which we'll discuss makes life harder for people who are reversing the app. So we'll reverse an app and see. Before going ahead, just keep this thing in mind. In a lot of countries, reverse engineering is a federal offense. All the process and tools which we'll discuss here, don't use it on any other app, and just don't try to steal someone's app or code or data. This the aim of this presentation is just to let you know what others can use it on your app and how you can protect it on your own. Okay? So let's deassemble an app. So typically an app is on your phone. So the first thing which you'll need is an APK. So how do you get an APK? So there are a lot of utilities which is there on in Android marketplace. The most simple is you install an app called APK extractor. Okay, launch the app in your launch the app in your phone. So this is a simple app. So APK extractor, what it does is it just lists the phones, lists the apps which is there in your phone. Okay, so this tool, when you launch it, it just lists the number of apps which is there in the phone. You click on the app, it will generate an APK and store it in your SD card. That's it. That simple to generate an APK of any app which you download from Google Play. Okay, so first thing which we wanted to get is the APK. So we use a tool called APK extractor, got the APK. Now you have an APK in your Android phone, you can copy it in your machine. So what is the next thing? So APK is what we have seen. The APK which gets built is nothing but a compressed file format which is being used by Android. So when I say compressed file format, it's just like another zip compression thing. So if it's a compressed format, that means it can be decompressed using standard zip utilities. So let's see. So I have this APK, okay? Are you able to see this? So what I do is I use a utility called 7-zip. It's an open source utility. You can use WinZip or WinRAR, whatever is your choice. What I do is I just right click on APK and say extract. Just extract, okay? What should you get? What should you get out of APK? If you remember the process of the build, APK is nothing but the collection of resources and dex file, and there is something called manifest. So when you decompile an APK, I should not use the word decompile, when you extract the APK, these three things you should get. So let's see what we got. So this is, okay, can you see this? What we got is classes, the resources and the manifest file. Okay, so the first level is broken. So you decompile, so you decompress an APK, you got all the things which are there. So let's see what is there in asset. So asset is typically a folder which is used to supply anything which is not a Java or XML or a image. So let's say you have an app which has a nice MP3 which plays whenever someone opens an app. So what you need to do is you have to pre-bundle the MP3 with the app which will get installed. So that things you will put in asset. And eventually, let's say if you want to pre-bundle a database with your app. So let's say you want to have some information in your app, no matter if someone is connected to internet or not. So you have a database. That database is very easily accessible. Can you see this database? This is an SQLite 3DB, which you just got by de-extracting the APK. So let's say if you have a sensitive database, don't pre-bundle it with your app. It is very easy. So let's say you have created a nice app, you collected data from a lot of places and you want to give an offline functionality to your users. So you said, what I do, I pre-supply the SQLDB with my app. And anyone who wants to use that database can just extract your APK and get access to this DB. Let's see what is there in this DB. So if you are not, so this is an SQLite DB browser. So if you are not using any encryption, what you get is you get all the information which is there in the database. Okay, and this is possible. So even if you are not pre-bundling your app with database, it is in rooted form. It is possible that if you are storing and sensitive information in SQLite DB, I can extract that DB out from your asset folder in your app without decompiling the app altogether. So ultimately, this DB, when you install in your app, when you install an app in your phone, it gets stored in your SD card or some location, and that location is accessible on rooted phones. So let's say your app, which uses some sensitive data of your own, which is not related to user. So let's say some key of your own, which you are storing in DB without encrypting, someone can go and hack it. So this is simple. What we got is DB. Okay. So let's go and see what else is there. So resources, we have images, DB assets. Okay. Let's see. So I saw an app and I liked the cool icon which had. Now I want to copy it. Lot of times you would have seen the same icon of Temple Run being used for some false apps. How do they do it? See, if you go in resource folder, you see all the icons which is there in the app. There is no way you can protect the images. Okay, it will be accessible. So that's this way you can copy the, and let's say, okay, I like an app which has some fancy layout with some animation and I want to see how they do it. So they would have spent some two or three developers and they have coded the nice fancy UI. What you can do is you can go in layout and you can see the XML. So basically this XML will be encoded. I'll show you how to decode it. Okay. So what we got is we got the manifest files, we got all the assets, we got all the images. Okay. So let's see the manifest file. So manifest is a, so those who are not aware of Android, so manifest is a file where you define all the settings of your app which will be used by Google Play or Google OS, Android OS to install the app on a specific thing. So if you just plainly see, this is an encoded XML. This is not just, so when you see there is another two. Okay, so what I have is, what I will do is I will say java minus jar xml dot jar. I'll say android manifest.xml, say plain text.txt. That's it. And what I get is, I get all your XML file. Nicely decoded. Okay, so now I can see. So why is an XML android manifest or layout files are important? So layout you can anyways use to see what animation someone is doing and how you can implement it on your own. Manifest can give you a lot of metadata information about the code. Okay, so let's move on. Okay, so now what have we decompiled or de-extracted? So we got the images, we got the manifest file. But what is our interest? We want to steal the code. We got the images, we got the DB. Now I want to show them that, okay, I can steal your code. So the code is currently in its DEX format. So DEX is nothing but a compiled class files in a DEX, converted DEX files. So there are some nice guys who have created this utility called dex2jar. There are some other utilities. So there are some intermediate code formats like Smally and all, which gets converted into. But this is a nice utility. What it does is directly convert the DEX files into a jar file. And then we can use any jar decompiler to read the jars. We'll see that. So let's generate the class files. Okay, we go here again. We say D. Okay, what is the name of the class file? Classes.dex. Just observe what is going on. So, let me. Okay, so what you are seeing here is a jar file getting generated. Okay. Okay, so we got the jar file. So let's say for folks who are not using ProGuard, what will happen? So I got the jar file. Okay, I use this tool called JDGUI. Okay, here are my jar files. I just drop it. And voila, I have the code. Wow. So I can read all your code now. So if you are not using ProGuard, this is what I can do with your code. And let's say if I am smart, what I'll do is, I'll go to search, I'll say HTTP, okay, string. I don't even have to go step by step. oh, this is your hidden APIs. You can see all the parameters which are being passed, whatever gimmicks you are doing, and this way the code is completely hackable for someone else. Okay? So this is when you are not using any code protection techniques. Okay? So this is how simple it is to decompile an app in Android. So we just use a few utilities, not even built by me. I just use as open source tools which are available in the market and decompiled an app altogether. And it not took more than 10 minutes for me to decompile an app. Okay. So what are the code protection tools? So I said there is something called ProGuard. So ProGuard is a tool which comes pre-bundled nowadays with Android. So it's a simple tool. It not only helps you to obfuscate your code, but it also gives you it solves two more purposes. It acts as a shrinker. Okay. So the APK file which you generate without ProGuard and with ProGuard will have a lot of difference in the file size. And if you are a developer, file size do matter. So if people can download your app fast, they can use it faster. Because in India specifically, the connections are at very low latency, at high latency and low speed. So the APK size matters. And this tools give you straight away. You don't have to do anything. It will automatically shrink everything for you. No configuration is required. Just one click, it will shrink. It will also optimize, so it will remove the unused classes, variables which are not being used, comments, all things, and generate the APK for you. So let's see how you use the ProGuard in your Android project. So when you create an Android project, nowadays what happens is there is something called ProGuard.config.txt file which gets generated, which will come here. It is not here in my project. Okay. So this is the file. So what you can do is, the file name could be anything. It doesn't matter. Okay, you say ProGuard.me, ProGuard.abcd. Okay, how do you define the ProGuard file is, you go in your project.properties. So this is the property which will be used when you create an app. You say that what is my ProGuard configuration by this ProGuard.config. So what I will say is, okay, you pass the path of the file. Okay, so let's say if your file is not located in the parent directory, you pass the file name and the path. So I say ProGuard.config is my ProGuard file. If you see this, you go to, okay, so when you open this file in your first time when you generate, it will be blank. So how do I know when I starting first time that how, what to do, what configuration should we need? So go to this website of ProGuard, ProGuard.source. So if you search on Google ProGuard, you will get this website. So it comes with a, and if you search for sample ProGuard files, there is a complete Android application sample. So you can see here, these are like de facto ProGuard configuration which comes in Android. Okay. So what it is saying is, boss, please don't obfuscate code which is related to Android. Rest you obfuscate everything. Okay. So why it saying like that? Because if they obfuscate code which is related to Android, your app may crash because it might not find the symbol. And the manifest has ABCD name, but when ProGuard obfuscated it, the name of your activity become A. So this is just saying that, okay, what are the files which you don't have to obfuscate? What is the level of obfuscation which you are looking for? And a lot of, okay, let's see the sample ProGuard which I am using. Okay, so I'm just saying keep public class extended Android app activity. I'm not able to see, let me, okay. So there are a lot of time when you use ProGuard, most of the time the problem which you people face is you have library files. So you have to explicitly tell ProGuard that don't obfuscate library files. Otherwise what will happen is, it might be possible that libraries which you are using already use ProGuard and they are already obfuscated. So it will try to obfuscate again and it will fail. So you have to tell ProGuard that what are the library jars which is there in your project. And these are some warnings which you have to tell ProGuard that, okay, in case you are getting any warning on this related things, just ignore it. So these are my flag. So Flurry is a analytics tool which I am using in my app. Jackson is a parser, JSON parser which I am using. So I am telling ProGuard that, okay, boss, please don't warn me about warnings which comes for this. And these are my libraries. Okay. So this is a sample ProGuard file. Everyone got like, so what will happen is, when that's it, this two configuration is needed. You enable the flag here in your project.properties and you define the ProGuard file. So what will happen is, when you generate an APK this time, remember the slide which we are showing the build process. So now the Android build process automatically runs ProGuard, taking your configuration file on the class level. Okay, so automatically it will obfuscate, optimize and shrink the APK. Okay, nothing has to be done. So you right click and say generate APK and it will be generated. So let's see a code which is reversed with ProGuard. So I already have the code, since we don't have much time, I'll just show you. So this is the ProGuard generated APK which I reversed it. ProGuard works only on class level, so you're still not able to protect the DB, you're still not able to protect your assets and manifest, but most of the business logic resides in your code, so it will protect your code. So let's see. Off. So can you see the difference? The second tab is of ProGuard. The first tab is of non-ProGuard. So if you see here, in this, this was my package name. Earlier you used to see all the files which were there in my code, constants and all. But since we told ProGuard that, okay, everything you obfuscate apart from my activity and other files, it left this files, only these four files, okay? And rest, it moved everything, it obfuscated everything. So what? How typically ProGuard works is, it just renamed your variables and class names to simpler names like A, B, C and automatically reference it. So wherever it's kind of renaming all the class names and variable names and some other techniques. So if you see here, so what happens is now with the name of the application, name of the method, you're not able to identify what this app is doing. So this is the most which you can do with free tools which is available. Okay. So you can achieve at this level. Okay. So you're making it difficult for someone to understand what is going on in your code. Where ProGuard lacks is it doesn't obfuscate strings. It obfuscates the variable, not the strings. So if you still search, so it would have renamed constants. It would have renamed constants to something else, but it has not been removed. It just make it difficult for someone to see the code. Okay, still you will be able to search your your key. Since your key, API says HTTP, it doesn't obfuscate string literals. Okay, when you say where string my API is equal to something, it will my API it will obfuscate to A, B or A dot B or something, but it will leave the string intact. So that is how it works. So it doesn't give you foolproof security, but it makes life of the hacker simple. It makes the life of the people who want to decompile your app little harder, okay, by renaming it. So what happens is when you follow the standard in coding, you always name the variables very intuitively. So if someone is just looking at your code, he can very easily understand if you, the string literals still remains, the variable name still remains the same which you had. So let's say if a function says verify login, he'll understand that, okay, this function is using for verify login, and then he can start inferring that, okay, how your logic works. But here in case of ProGuard, what will happen is the function name will be ABC and the logic will be changed. The variable name will be A, C, something. So it will be difficult for him to understand what is going on in the code. Okay, so the code, if you see here, the code is not readable. Okay, you can't say what this code is doing. Similarly, like this. So the only problem here is it works at a certain level, but if you want even deeper protection, you have to go and switch for commercial tools. So if you have enterprise apps which you want to protect IPs and all, you can go for the commercial tool. So I have evaluated a tool and used it in my company called dexguard. It is by the same creator of ProGuard. So he has extended the tool with a commercial offering where he offers certain level of protection apart from ProGuard. So it will have all the functionality of ProGuard, but it will also comes with something called string encryptions. Okay, so you can encrypt the entire string. I'll show you the jar file which I decompiled with dexguard. Also, it comes with something very interesting. So what happens is, I said that games can be pirated, correct? So what they do is they remove the licensing thing from the app altogether. So dexguard also gives you some licensing protection techniques where you can detect that whether the license has been tampered. If it has been tampered, the app will not work altogether. So these are just selling points of dexguard which the guy claims on his website. Okay, let's see a dexguard compiled file.
Excuse me?
Yeah.
For example, we are encrypting something using a key. Which is the best place to keep the key in the code?
Sarvat.
Sir.
So, if you are not using a tool like this.
No, what if it is an offline app?
Then use a random number generator. So now in 4.2 and above, Android earlier people were using their own algorithm to generate some salt and grain salt for AES encryption.
Is
now,
it
not this, the random number generator, the AES encryption which I am talking about is now for 4.2 and above. So it's an inbuilt function which will automatically use the randomness from the OS level and generates a key for you. So at the time when the app gets launched first time, you generate the key and store it somewhere. Okay, but still hackable. Okay, so if you store it in your shared preference. So if you wonder if your shared preferences are safe, no, your shared preferences are not safe. If I have a rooted phone, I can access your shared preference as well. So shared preference or preferences are nothing but flat files which get stored in memory. Okay.
How do you debug obfuscated as such if you want to?
No. So if you see here, what happens is, just see. So this is the commercial tool which I was talking about, which I am just using. So what I say is, I say to the tool that please obfuscate the strings also. Okay. So if you now search here, okay, if you search HTTP here, there is nothing. This is old code. Okay. It is showing for the other thing. If I want to search, there is nothing. It is not there. This button is not visible. See, there is no HTTP in your entire code. And even after this, your app will work as it is. So what the commercial tool was offering is they can encrypt the strings also. Okay.
See, and basically in this, they will be encrypting this thing. So like in the binary, this if this thing gets encrypted, so that needs to decrypt at the runtime.
Correct. So there is an overhead of this. But if you really want to protect it, there is a reflection which will be involved. So it clearly says that don't go ahead and blindly encrypt everything. Okay, use it wisely. Okay, in ProGuard what happens is it is just renaming the things.
Correct. So there is no runtime cost.
Yeah, but here there are runtime costs. If you want, I'll just show you a simple file. So if you see here, what I am telling the tool is, it works, since it was created by ProGuard, it works on the same configuration. So what I say is encrypt string which starts with HTTP and start. So anything which starts with HTTP, it will encrypt. Okay, so let's say you want to protect few sensitive things, you can protect it using this tool. And this is a commercial tool. So if you want to protect that sensitive information, first of all, don't keep that kind of information in the app, because it's an app, it will be hackable. But if you really want to protect the apps, let's say enterprise apps, they want a high grade security, use these tools. What are some other techniques which can be used to protect the code? So these are all research papers which I have read. So all talk about few things. I haven't seen some tools which is commercial or something which can help you. So there is something called junk by insertion. So what they do is they analyze the code and see that on memory, where are the places on which your code is not there. And they'll just insert garbage in that. So what will happen is when you will decompile the app, what you are seeing is garbage, is not the actual code. So it makes it even harder. But I haven't seen a tool which can be just can do this very easily. The guy who written this technique has used specific app. He did an analysis of his own and inserted it. So the technique might not work on. So there's something called dynamic code loading, where it says that okay, you load the code which is sensitive dynamically. There are few people who are doing that. So what they do is things which are so let's say API. So what they do is they make an API call to retrieve information for APIs. Okay, so this kind of thing, self-modifying code, so the code looks something else, but internally when you start, it automatically modifies itself and do something else. So whenever someone is reversing, he's seeing the actual, he's not seeing the actual thing. Obfuscation at dex level, so dexguard works at kind of that level, not sure. So this way we saw how you protect the code. So, but Google came up recently with this nice util, so which can help you to protect your APIs. So what happens is lot of time, you create APIs just for the Android app, and you are not using open APIs. You are using some APIs of your own, or you are paying for the API which you don't want others to consume. Okay, so how this technique works is, if you use a Facebook auth or Google authentication, what will happen is you call a util passing your OAuth, it will give a pop-up to a user saying that please authorize. Same concept being used here, but only thing what happens is you register first your app on the Google Play console, you'll get a key, kind of this big key. Now, when you call, there is an auth util in Google Play, from Google Play services, so any app which is, any phone which is running Google Play service, Google Play store can use this. So what you do is, you call this util, this is a Java function, and say get token. When you call this Java function, you pass this as a, you pass this, instead of, so in case of OAuth, what you say is, instead of audience, you say OAuth. So it will automatically give a pop-up. In case of this, what happens is, Google auth util checks this client ID. It queries the Google server and see that, okay, this client ID is registered to this app. That means the user has already authorized this app because he has downloaded it and accepted the terms and conditions. So without giving any pop-up, when you pass this in a scope, without giving any pop-up, Google Play service returns you an auth token. Okay, so what will happen is, as soon as you call this util, immediately you get an access token. So this access token is nothing but a JSON payload. So now what you do is, every API, so this, use this method only for sensitive API calls, because there is some override. I'll explain where. So what you do is, you pass this token every time you make a API call to your servers. So apart from your query parameters, you pass this token. Now what will happen on your backend is, you query the Google server. So Google signed this token with their private key, when it comes with Google Auth. So when you query Google server, first thing you have to check is whether someone has modified this key or someone wants to hack it. So what people can do, and always use HTTPS, so there is no man in middle attack chances. But let's say someone got hold of your API parameters and he is generating the OAuth token for you and passing it in your parameters. So what will happen is that token will not be signed from Google. So when you do an MD public private key, it will fail. When you do the checksum, it will fail. So first thing which you do is, you verify with Google. There are utilities from Google which help you, which is very instant, very fast. So what it will do is, it will say yes or no, whether this is signed by Google or not. So this is first level protection which you can do. So okay, so it says no, you automatically rejects the call. So that way your API is safe. But let's say someone is very smart. So what he do is, he creates similar app, okay, do a auth util, passing his own app ID, generates the token. Now the token is signed by Google, correct? But instead of querying his backend, he query your backend. So now this will always pass, correct? So the second layer is, what happens is, when you verify this token, you get back three parameters from Google. What this parameter contains is, this parameter will contain your app ID, okay, and the email address which you have used. So what you can do is, whenever you return this parameters from Google, you verify that, okay boss, this is from my app ID, and then only. So this two level authentication, make sure that your APIs are not accessed outside your app, okay? So even if someone did this part, the token which you will get after verification will contain his app ID, not your app ID. So you're not able to crack the API. So this is a technique which recently launched by Google. It works on all versions of OS which are 2.2 and above. Only condition is, it has to have a Google Play installed on the phone, Google Play services running on the phone. Okay. Any question in this? Okay. So let's see. So if you don't want to go in that level of protection, there are some simple tools and there are simple techniques which you can use to protect your API. Use HTTPS. You can use a self-signed HTTPS, so no need to pay for a certificate. Install in self-signed certificate. And you can use HTTPS as self-sign. Hide your URL parameters. Don't just blindly do a get call. Always use post. Okay. Use time encoding parameters. These are standard way to protect your APIs. You pass a time stamp in the API. You can encrypt that. And every time on your server, you check that whether, okay, it's 5 minutes or 6 minutes, whatever you want. So in case when someone got the complete URL, hold a complete URL, it will not work for more than 2 or 4 minutes with this time stamp. Use user agent identifier. Typically used by lot of API developers. So what you do is so whenever it is being called from Google, whatever library you are using, it might have appending some user agent identifier, or there must be no user identifier. So what you can detect is if it is coming from Mozilla or something just blindly rejects that. So these are like tools and techniques which you can use for protecting your APIs. So we have seen like we are easily accessing the DB. So how do you go and protect the DB? One thing you can do is hash your data. So there you can use encryption, AES encryption, generate the key randomly or get the key from your servers. If you are storing the key, there is no point. If someone can reverse it, they can see the... So if someone is very smart, he can figure it out that you are storing the key locally, he'll get the key and reverse it. Use third-party encryption database. There's something called SQL Cipher, which is free. You can use that. It's a commercial tool. It's a free tool. They have a commercial version also. Use string encryptions. Always store sensitive data which you have encrypting the DB. So I'll sum up the whole talk. So nothing is foolproof. So it's not like you can completely protect the app. But just don't give away the code for free. Just, okay, sir, take it. Use tools which are there for free, at least for free, which are there, and techniques which are there, which can be easily implemented, so that you can prevent someone to just gain access to your code. You make their life difficult. Use ProGuard. It's a very nice tool. It will give you not only obfuscation, but it will shrink to a certain extent. So what I have seen is 800 KB APK, which was not generated with ProGuard, comes down to 623 KB. And if you have bigger images and all, it will compress a lot.
But how does like ProGuard could change the size of binary? Because
it doesn't work on the binary.
Okay, you are talking about text files.
No, so ProGuard, so Android tool automatically takes runs ProGuard when it is converting this class files, Java to class. So what ProGuard? No, Java to class, not class to dex.
Okay.
So what ProGuard do is it will remove all the code which is not being used in your file. All the comments, and they have certain levels of techniques.
See, comments are not there in the binaries.
Correct. So they'll remove all the unused codes. They'll, I think, since they are renaming the. So let's say you have.
Renaming doesn't matter in assembly translation. When you are in the class file, those are assembly.
No. So when you rename it to smaller file names, smaller variable names, it does give some benefits. So there is some overhead which is stored as class files. If you have sensitive APIs like payments or something which is there, use Google API verification for sensitive. So if you have any questions, you can just throw away. And you can reach me here. Thank you for attending the session. If you want, can ask questions or we can wrap it up.
Is it possible to disable the list of APK which are already
installed? No, it's in your phone, so you own the content. And it's not like, okay, so it's not only from phone where you can get the APK. So people have written utils, which will, there is one Python script. What it does, it query the Google Play and get the APK from there. Or even you would have seen this. You can install an APK from, let's say you can install an app from web, where you say install, and whenever you get connected, the Google will push the APK to you. So what people are doing is they're intercepting that also. So they'll put a Wireshark in between, they'll put a proxy server, and whatever is coming, they'll just scan that, and the APK will always a complete file, which will not like come. So they'll just get the URL, they'll download on it. So there is no way you can protect the getting of APK. But yeah, you can always detect that there is some tampering which happened. You can write your intelligent thing which just says that you generate a random number each time which is getting generated only through your algorithms. But this thing is worse when something is online. If it is offline, it's very difficult to protect.
How do you detect manifest?
So there is a so these are the some useful links. Okay, so it's a simple utility. It's not related to Android at all. So these are typically encoded XMLs. So there is a utility which just decode. So it is called AXML 2 printer.
So you mentioned about this ARX token retrieval from Google. Is there a possibility to have third party applications? Performs the same service.
Yes. So actually Google is doing the same. So all phones which comes with Google Play service, So Google Play service is a third party thing which is doing. Why it is simpler is because Google is maintaining all the servers.
I need online access, right?
Correct.
If you don't have online access.
But then how will you, where will you verify?
Let's say, okay.
Inside the app.
Can this just think here?
No, so, see, if you are generating the token in your app and you are verifying the token in the app, it doesn't work.
I specifically my key.
Okay, so you're saying that the app just gives me whether it's a, could be possible. But then the problem is how many people will install the other app, which is necessary to. So here the problem is being solved because Google is supplying Google Play services with all the phones which get. Thank you.